happy and honored to introduce Reverend Bob Oshta. And Reverend Bob grew up in post-war San Francisco, attending the Buddhist Church of San Francisco. I know Miles is here cheering. So he completed his undergraduate studies in psychology at UC Berkeley, followed by graduate studies at the Institute of Buddhist Studies in Berkeley. From 1973 to 75, he lived in Kyoto, Japan, where he received his Tokudo and Kyoshi certification. His first ministerial assignment was at the LA Betsuin. In 1978, Reverend Bob took a leave and returned to active ministry in 1984 at the Sacramento Betsuin. In 2003, he became Rinbang and retired in 2016 after serving the Sacramento Betsuin for 32 years. That same year, Bob and Patty accepted the invitation to become the chaplains for the California State Assembly for 4 years. His hobbies are reading, good, and practicing yoga, and dreams of mastering his bass guitar. So very honored and happy to welcome Reverend Bob Oshta.
Thank you, Bob. I don't know what I'm doing here. I noticed that Itomi-san and Patty and I, we opened with our disclaimers. And let me begin with mine that I'm certainly no yoga expert. In fact, I only became interested in yoga as when Patty mentioned that she was able to secure Bob as our to share an introduction, a one-time introduction to yoga class for her programs, the monthly health and wellness series on Zoom. And I'm sure absolutely all of you have been actively involved with yoga, practicing yoga much, much longer than I have been. But both Patty and I are today here at Bob's special invitation. You know, Bob never asks for anything. And so it's virtually impossible to say no to him when he asks. So here I am. It was only 2 years ago, as I mentioned, that Bob eased Patty and I into the practice of and to appreciate yoga. And as Patty also mentioned, after finding out that one of the main books of yoga was the Bhagavad Gita, we really did become quite intrigued, because 50 years ago, while in college, one of the books that really resonated deeply with me was the Bhagavad Gita. I mean, how many books do we keep for 50 years and read, you know, multiple times? This is it. This is it. I bought it in 1970, and I bought other copies and given them away over the years. I don't know, should I tell this story? No. Let me get right into it. Considering the topic I've been given is yoga and Buddhism, a deep connection. Again, I have a second disclaimer that, you know, I'm certainly not a Buddhist scholar. I'm just a new and curious student of yoga. And I consider myself just a truly fortunate person to have been able to live my life with the help of wonderful Dharma friends and inspiring Dharma teachers. So with that said, let me try to share what I've come to feel is an interesting, if not inseparable, connection of Buddhism and yoga. I think it might help to try to define them both to begin with, so let me try. First with what is Buddhism. In conversation with some of you here over the weekend so far, I talked about how before retiring 7 years ago, for almost 32 years, all of those 32 years, we taught the Metta Padma class at the Betsuin. This is a Girl Scout and Boy Scout religious award class for the 8, 9, and 10-year-olds. And it's really, I found in teaching this class that I really began to become a teacher. And I had to learn again, what is Buddhism? Because there's nothing like teaching 8, 9, 10 year olds because they're so honest. If they get something, their eyes light up and it feels so good. And if you're not reaching them, they're like, you know, falling asleep, they're picking their nose and poking each other, and it's so obvious. And when they weren't getting it, I had to ask myself, you know, what am I doing that's not making it possible for them to understand? Because you know, I must not understand Buddhism well enough to be able to explain it if they're not getting it. So I had to think more deeply, more simply, you know, what is the Dharma? And so it was in teaching them that, you know, I discovered that, you know, I began to understand better the Dharma for myself. And so today, let me try to define Buddhism as I would with my Metapadma students, 8, 9, and 10 years old. And I'm really speaking to the 9-year-old in all of you. And as Patty just mentioned, she was talking to Debbie and said that, yeah, Bob's basically 9 years old, so when he's with that class, he's in his peer group. So essentially, and all of you know this, Buddhism is the teaching of change and oneness. This is what I would teach my kids. Buddhism is the teaching of change and oneness. It's the teaching of impermanence and interdependence. The teaching that reminds us to look around and see that in life, everything is constantly changing. And yet at the same time, all things are one. All things are interconnected and one. So in all of the teachings of Buddhism, come back to these two essential teachings with impermanence and interdependence. And when I would teach this, I would tell our kids, everything that I'm going to teach you, it comes back to change and oneness, impermanence and interdependence. And I'd make them say it again and again and again. And, you know, it sounds very simple. I mean, truly, you know, even a 9, 8 year old, a 5 year old can get this. But to paraphrase the legendary 10th century Chinese Zen Buddhist master Hotei, even a young child can understand this. But even a long-lived and worldly person would find it hard to truly grasp and live with the awareness that nothing is forever. That in living life in time, we must know the loss of people we love. And yet at the same time, all things are interconnected in one. In our Metapadma class, we call impermanence and interdependence the two eyes of Buddhism that help us to see the nature of life. And with Dharma eyes open, we cannot help but see that everything truly is constantly changing. That we've come to this retreat, and although most days we wake up and feel pretty much the same, we are each going to leave this retreat changed people. So constantly we are becoming, we are constantly becoming. Every moment we're alive, we're constantly becoming. The wonderful Dharma teacher, the late Thich Nhat Hanh, would hold up a piece of paper and say, "Can you see the sun in this paper?" And then he would explain to his puzzled audience, the sun shined upon a seed, the environment was right, and the seed grew into a tree that would later become pulp and made into this paper. Do you see the sun in this paper? It was his way of trying to show us the interconnected oneness of all things. All life exists because of the sun. That's why we actually really like the sun salutation. It comes from this reverence for the life-giving sun, that we are all one with the sun. Oh, that's one of my favorite Santana songs. I don't know if you know that one. It's pretty good. But anyway, Thich Nhat Hanh would show and try to share by this with this example that all things are interconnected, And we are not separate from the environment and the universe. We're all one. This was, I think, one very effective way to help us understand interdependence and oneness. Buddhism teaches us that nothing happens in a vacuum. All things are interwoven in the karmic fabric of the universe, and all life is interconnected in the karmic fabric of life. Now, with that simple understanding of Buddhism being the teaching of change and oneness, impermanence and interdependence, keep this in mind as we now move forward with my definition of yoga. I think already Hitomi-san and Bob and Patty has alluded to also. So, and I'm sure you all know this already, as was mentioned a few times by the previous speakers, but I discovered it. So it was brand new to me, and I get all excited because I'm reading this and think, wow. Discovered that yoga is actually the root word for the English word yoke. Huh? Yoke. As you know, this is the harness that joins like two ox together and helps the ox be connected to the cart. So yoga is most often defined as meaning to join or bind together. And as I mentioned, I know you've all heard this at some time, and it alludes to binding the body, mind, and spirit. Even more, it is connecting our body, mind, and spirit to the moment that is now. And what I found fascinating, that yoga is ancient. I mean, it is truly ancient. It's older than Hinduism. And Hinduism is over 4,000 years old. It is mentioned in the Vedantic tradition in the Indus Valley that gave rise to the Vedas and is part of the soil and the sun that gave birth to especially Hinduism, Buddhism, and Jainism. And we have to keep in mind, I think, that Siddhartha was raised steeped in the Hindu tradition. And although his teaching in a way was a rebellion from, I think there's also a deep connection. How do we separate the tree from the soil? We are all part of the earth, and so is our Dharma tradition. So here in the West, as also has been mentioned, we often think of yoga as a stretching exercises with these poses. As Hitomi-san showed the picture of sometimes the poses might be in some excruciating posture requiring a level of physical dexterity that few people could ever imagine duplicating. And this is exactly what I thought too when Bob asked Patty, hey, are you too interested in maybe learning yoga? I thought, no way this body of mine is going to contort, to the poses that I was imagining, which reminds me, prior to this, Patty was getting her little Lululemon outfits, and I thought, hey, I should get some Lululemon outfits, And she said, no, Bob, they don't have Lululemon. I said, now that's a good marketing idea, Rick, huh? Lululemon for the larger yoga. The rounder, more full-bodied. But anyway, I just thought about it. That's a good, you can have that. But back to my point, to my surprise, I found, as has also been mentioned by my speakers, I feel validated, that the practice of yoga is so much more than just exercises and poses. And let me back up again for a moment, but Bob explained to us, as Hitomi-san had mentioned, that there are two essential books that are the foundation of yoga. It's the Bhagavad Gita and the Yoga Sutra, both of two I have here today. But let's see. One, of course, that we have already talked about, the Bhagavad Gita. The other is a Yoga Sutra by Patanjali, and is sometimes mentioned, historic times, I'm not sure how valid they are, but Patanjali is a sage that is said to have lived about 200 BCE. And he did not invent yoga. Yoga, as I mentioned, is ancient. I mean, it is before written history. And my explanation of this is certainly an oversimplification, but after yoga was around for a few thousand years, the teachings of yoga were many and varied, and in a way difficult to grasp. So Patanjali is credited for organizing and clarifying the teachings, the practice, and the goal of yoga in his Yoga Sutras. So when Bob recommended reading the Yoga Sutras, he recommended a translation, and Patty immediately went on Amazon and ordered it. And for the past 18 months or so, I found myself just thoughtfully digesting this book. And I was so impressed with the messages and the way they're presented that, you know, I've said more than once to Bob that I can imagine the historical Buddha sharing the Dharma in just such a way. But this again, you know, I'm detracting, and perhaps I'll elaborate more on this later, but let me get back on track. In reading the Yoga Sutras, Patanjali emphasizes that yoga was not meant to just be a physical practice. In fact, in the whole of the Yoga Sutras, within the 195 sutras or the teachings, only three of those talk about asanas or poses. Only three. And this alone indicates that yoga is the goal of yoga is not simply to be mastering physical poses. And what I also appreciated about yoga, as has been mentioned before, that like Buddhism, the Yoga Sutra's teachings are not about believing anything. And in fact, it's not considered a religion. The concern is with our living better and connecting with our sense of the universal, a sense of oneness and interdependence with all things. Sound familiar? So just connecting with our conscious with the universal conscious, as Bob had mentioned in yoga in his presentation today. Yoga might be said, well, the Buddha might say, you know, that what we have to do, our goal is to awaken to the oneness of all things. And this is what Patanjali also had written in the Yoga Sutra, that we are trying to unite with the infinite. And this is what he says in there, union with the infinite is the real yoga. That's a quote. Union with the infinite is the real yoga. But the infinite has no name. And it's difficult to understand anything with no name. And using no words makes it difficult to comprehend anything. It's very hard to communicate without words. You know, in our Buddhist tradition, there's a famous story of a disciple of the Buddha, Mahakashpa, who was said to be able to, there was a time when the Buddha was about to give a talk, and it says there was a great assembly of monks, and here about to hear the Buddha present the Dharma message. And he just held up a flower. And only Mahakashpa smiled. And they made this connection that, you know, something was communicated. But we are not like Mahakashpa, unfortunately. And, you know, words are needed to communicate, although we know words are limited. But our ancient spiritual ancestors felt that the infinite had a sound, a vibration that included all vibrations and all sounds. And that sound vibration they taught as Aum, that we did the Aum chanting earlier. It was quite wonderful. We've been doing it online individually, but to hear a room full of people chanting Aum, you know, it's just, and just to be in a room full of people chanting, you know, it's so wonderful. It doesn't matter what they're chanting. To hear people chanting together when we were chanting the Vandana Tisanana, just to chant continuous Nembutsu, it's just so wonderful to feel the spirit, the vibration of voices, human voices. So again, you know, getting back to the point, yoga is not about believing anything, but it has the goal of getting beyond our selfish nature. The goal is to help us connect with that infinite, getting beyond our selfish nature, and trying to connect with the inconceivable infinite. This is the expression of Aum. So stick with me here. I'm not going to get too crazy. This is as far as I hope I'll go with this, in trying to explain Aum. So as I understand it, in Aum chanting in the yoga tradition, they are encouraging us to get beyond our dualistic judgmental thought. Our sessions with Bob now begin with the chanting of Aum, and for Aum, part of it represents the beginning. And I think with our restorative at the endings, we are closing with our silent Aum. The chanting of Aum represents both the beginning, the end, and everything in between. I've long been a fan of Joseph Campbell. I hope most of you are familiar with him. Although Joseph Campbell died in 1987, he's come to be considered one of the greatest authorities on the religions and mythologies of humanity. And over the years, I've often shared Joseph Campbell's definition of Buddhism, where I really like the clarity and simplicity of how he defined the Dharma. He would say, in his words, when asked, "What is Buddhism?" he said, "Buddhism is that teaching that takes us from ignorance to illumination." I always liked that. Buddhism is that teaching that takes us from ignorance to illumination. So simple. What impressed me from the very first time that I watched his famous interviews and then later read his books was the respect and the admiration with which he approached every spiritual tradition of humanity. He would often say that overcoming dualities is a part of the hero's journey. Overcoming dualities is a part of the hero's journey. And he wrote a book, A Hero with a Thousand Faces. But overcoming dualities is a part of the hero's journey. In other words, realizing our oneness with all things, really realizing our interdependence is significant, so that our journey through life will be a meaningful one. Joseph Campbell also described Aum as the sound of mystery. The sound of mystery. And I'm going to quote him here. He said, "Aum is a word that represents to our ears the sound of the universe of which all things are manifestations. Aum pronounced properly, all vowel sounds are represented." Then he said, and I continue to quote, "Consonants fragment the sound of Aum. Consonants fragment the sound of Aum. They break up the sound of Aum, so all words are fragments of Aum. And Aum puts us in touch with the throbbing being of the universe. To be in touch with that throbbing being of the universe is a peak experience of Aum." So this is in what Joseph Campbell had to say about the Aum and Aum chanting. "Aum chanting puts us in touch with the throbbing being of the universe, and that's the peak experience of chanting Aum." And he called it the four element syllable, the four element syllable. Of course, we know the three parts of Aum, the A, U, M, Aum. But he said, Aum is the four element syllable. Patanjali refers to this too, but I had to go back. I read it in Patanjali, and I didn't really see it until I saw Joseph Campbell's explanation a little more clearly. Aum is the four syllable element, is the four element syllable, A is the birth. U is of coming into being, and mm is the dissolution. Ah, oom. Ah is the birth, u is the coming into being, and mm is the dissolution. And the fourth element, so these are the three elements, the fourth element is the silence. The silence out of which all things come and to which all things return. And that silence underlies all. He said, my life, this is what he said about himself, my life is Aum, and the silence that underlies it. It is the duality of the mortal and the immortal, the duality of the finite and the infinite. Patanjali calls this fourth element that Joseph Campbell considered silence. He said, it is the silent vibration that is always present. So in the Yoga Sutras, Aum is considered the silent vibration that is always present. So let's think about this for a moment as I imagine this. That when a baby is born, mouth opens, and the sound comes out. The baby's crying, ah. And when life comes to an end, if we are fortunate, it's with a quiet, literally, the beginning and the end. Joseph Campbell said that the meaning of Aum is beyond words. Beyond words. Words are all our dualistic qualifications and limitations. Words are our static conclusions. That's why Aum helps us to break past our sense of dualism every once in a while, he said. Every once in a while, Aum will help us feel a sense of oneness. We'll see, feel, maybe just for a moment, feel our finite selves connecting with the infinite, our conscious connecting with the infinite consciousness. So, to Joseph Campbell, he indicated that humanity is always trying to connect with that which is beyond. Humanity is always trying to connect with that which is beyond words and beyond conception. Other descriptions of Aum that I know all of you have heard is that Aum is the indivisible essence of all things. And once I heard that it is the primal sound of the universe. The primal sound of the universe. Now, with that explanation of Aum, I'd like just to think about and see that, you know, the impact of Aum on Buddhism remains reflected in the art and sculpture of Buddhism that we find in India, in Korea, in China. For Aum represents, to paraphrase again, Joseph Campbell, the emptiness from which all things come and all things return. And the emptiness, the sunyata, that underlies all things. It's amazing. So respected and admired was the sound of Aum that they are found in, let's see, the Buddhist guardian figures. So when we see these Buddhist guardian figures in China and Korea, Japan, you'll see them on the side of the Buddha. And always, I mean, if they're done correctly, one mouth is open and one mouth is closed. And the guardian figures are together making a silent Aum. Okay, these guardian figures are from the famous Todaiji Temple in Nara. And I think I read they were the largest guardian figure pair, at standing at almost 28 feet tall. And they date from the Kamakura era of Japan, of Shinran and Honen's time, again, Nichiren. It must have been a very interesting spiritual time around the world too, but in Japan especially. The guardian figure with mouth open is called Mishaku and represents birth. And Naraen, the guardian figure, has mouth closed and represents death. So beginning and the end. We're going to look at this next. And our Jodo Shinshu temples, you know, we have guardian figures too. And if you look at our altar, if when you go to the altar, take a look at the incense burner in the front. Probably you'll look like this is from the Sacramento Betsuin. And in Jodo Shinshu temples, we have guardian figures. And if you look carefully at the dragons together, see, one is mouth open on the right, mouth closed on the left. Mouth open. The impact of Aum in the Buddhist tradition remains very beautifully in the art and architecture. And then if you look on the altar, the Rosa Butate, the candle holders, we have crane guardian figures, and always one mouth is open, one mouth is closed. Can you see the one on the right? It's beautiful that we have these still remaining symbols of Aum within our temple. The connection of really respecting that this is a part of the spirituality that brought the Dharma to life. So it's even more prevalent than just even in these the architecture and art that we find in guardian figures. In Kyoto, very near the station, I think all of you know Toji Temple. If you go to Kyoto, even if you see pictures of Kyoto, of the maybe three or four places they will show, you're always going to see this pagoda. They show this pagoda. This is from the Toji Temple that's near the Kyoto Eki. And Toji was built when the capital of Japan was moved from Nara to Kyoto. And the emperor gave Toji Temple to Kobo Daishi or Kukai. And it's amazing because, how many of us can even imagine who invented the ABCs, huh? But Kukai invented hiragana. He invented hiragana. And it's just amazing to think that, Kukai, who lived in 774 to 835, he invented the hiragana syllabary. And the legend that I heard when I was in Kyoto, visiting Toji Temple, is that when Kukai was given Toji in completing the temple building construction, working on this, from what I understand, he was really amazing. You talk about, a genius, man of many talents. Kukai was an architect, an artist, a great spiritual leader. He went back to China to study the, especially I think Vipassana Buddhism. Came back and founded Shingon, but Kukai was building parts of Toji Temple and designing, and most of the workers, they were illiterate, and so in order for him to complete the temple, to build it to his satisfaction in a timely manner, he invented hiragana, phonetic syllabary, so that the workers, he could write down what he wanted and on the pieces of wood where this should go, and so the construction can continue even when he's no longer there. And it's amazing to think that Kukai, the founder of Shingon Buddhism, created hiragana. And hiragana starts with and it ends with what? The hiragana syllabary. Is the beginning. And when I went to Nihon Gakko, when I was going to Kimon Gakko in San Francisco, the used to be at the very end, right, the top, right? So it was the last row, on the top row, all by itself. So it starts with ah, ends with um, and we would learn that akasatana hamayara wa um. And so again, just as Joseph Campbell explained, starts with ah, and all the consonants break up the sound of om, which all words are part of. So not only is part found in the art and architecture, but in the literally the language of Japanese. So I'm trying to find the connection with Buddhism. I found, oh, there's not, it's not a connection, it's inseparable. They are one and a part of each other. So even here, I think with hiragana, we can't help but see the deep and respectful connection with the Buddha Dharma has, having its roots in the soil of the ancient Vedas, in yoga, and in the timeless universal Aum. So I think, you know, there are more connections that I was really enjoying finding, but I think this is probably a good place to kind of stop here and open it up for questions or comments. I think we all can feel, no, Buddhism and yoga, yoga and Buddhism, is there a deep connection? Yeah. So, questions, comments, thoughts?